drinking dark whiskey, telling white lies. One leads to another on a Saturday night. Don't you cross your heart and let your hope to die. Drinking dark whiskey, telling white lies.
Welcome back to Behind the Label. Today we're doing
Bourbon 101.
Yeah. And today's class is about
Jim Beam.
Jim Beam, in particular.
The biggest producer of bourbon in the world.
Yep. And as you can tell, there's a lot, they have a lot of individual bottles, but the weird thing is, they're all from the same mash bill.
They all start out with this one right here.
Right there.
Jim Beam.
I'm sure everyone that's watching this has seen
That's the best selling bourbon in the world right here. You know, great. Especially if you need something cheap. I mean, if you look at this right through here, besides the single barrel, everything's less than $25. So it won't break you.
It won't break your wallet.
It won't
break the wallet and make you real happy. So, but today we're going to talk about the different things you can do with the same mash bill to get more specialized products, which Jim Beam has kind of been the master of doing that. You can kind of tell from the array of bottles here. So let's just start with, what is their mash bill? What do we start off with here?
So we got, all of these are going to be the same. They're going to be 77-13-10. So 77% corn, 13% rye, 10% malted barley. So every single one of these.
Now, does the corn, does it have to be a special kind of, it can be any corn, any brand of corn?
I'm not exactly sure what they use. If they use the regular number 2 yellow. There's some that use like heirloom corn. Mm-hmm. Some like Jephthah Creed uses Bloody Butcher corn, so it's red. I think Bluegrass Distillers uses the blue corn on some of theirs. So, I mean, it just depends on.
So they can use different kinds of
different
corn.
Different kinds of corn.
As long as it's corn.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So before we start, so let's kind of talk about warehousing. So this is, the fourth one that we've done of these, Bourbon 101?
I think so, yeah.
So the first one was on Buffalo Trace, and we talked about taking same mash bill.
Mm-hmm.
So these are all been the same mash bill. And they were able to get theirs by the type of warehouse it was in, where in the warehouse it was in, how long it was aged.
Right.
So they've come up with five or six different products, actually at least six different products from same mash bill, depending on where they put it in the warehouse,
right,
how long they age it.
And now again, back just to kind of reiterate with that, with Buffalo Trace, it's kind of the opposite of the top shelf kind of idea of where the cheaper economical stuff is on the top.
Mid-range,
and then the top shelf, the stuff that you would see top shelf in the
Eagle
bar.
Rare, Pappy,
is on the bottom.
Weller, it's on the bottom.
Yeah.
And then we moved on from there. We talked about Woodford Reserve, because we're going to incorporate all of these, everything we've talked about so far into this.
Yeah.
And Woodford Reserve, we talked about, what did we talk about Woodford Reserve?
The same mash bill, but
finishing.
They took the same mash bill and basically put it in different kind of Cheerio or Cheerio.
They finished it different. Yeah, they took a product like their basic Woodford Reserve.
Yeah, some of it was double oaked.
Some of it was put into a secondary new charred oak barrel, and some of it was put in like the five wood, four different used barrels. So that was more about finishing, and then we went to Makers and we talked about proof.
Right.
How proof could have an effect on, you know, the taste of bourbon.
Yeah, and still the same mash bill.
Same maker's mark.
Some of it was basically their standard, 80 proof?
It was 90-some proof.
That's their basic. But then we went all the way up to like the cask strength on theirs.
And it was 109, I think, the one we had gotten. But proof makes a difference. So what we're doing, start out with the
classic.
The one everybody...
So we're going to be taking tiny amounts since we're have this much to go through. So we're going to.
Yeah, small amounts.
And still, this isn't like something I would turn my nose up at. You know,
so this is 77-13-10 on the mash bill. So it's a 4-year, but it's 80 proof.
So it's not bottle and bond. It's 4 years. It just missed bottle and bond by the
proof. Yeah, so it's only 80 proof. So,
I mean, you can even tell on the nose, it's a little harsher, you know, on the, it's got just a little bit of that more of a, raw smell to it, kind of. It just smells more like young bourbon.
Mm-hmm.
It just smells kind of like it's a little hard on the wood. It's a little harsh. You can just smell a little harshness.
Yeah. And this is $16. So like I said, this is the number one selling. One thing we're going to talk about too, warehousing. Whereas we talk, you know, Buffalo Trace, cheap, economical.
Yeah, let's say
economical on top, more expensive on the bottom. Jim Beam does their differently. Most all these products right here are going to be made out of the Boston plant. So if you watched our Jim Beam's episode, you would saw us.
Not all location. Their stuff is in Kentucky.
Yeah, Boston, Kentucky. Nobody knows where it's at. It's in the middle of nowhere where the Booker No plant is. So most of the Jim Beam's made there.
Yeah.
But you know, it could be stored at the Claremont facility or at the you know, even Old Granddad, it could be stored there. But what they do is still take it from the levels.
Creek, even behind them. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so they still have that.
Yeah, so they still take it from levels like Buffalo Trace does. Like I said, I kind of use the, if you've watched our episode, a baseball. And you have the cord, then you have the cowhide on the outside. And all the Jim Beam products would be the cowhide. So it was taken, Jim Beam was taken from the top of the warehouse, the sides of the warehouse, and the bottom of the warehouse.
So it's the envelope of the, that's kind of the more economical,
mm-hmm.
the part of the I guess the barrels that would be closest to the wall, ceiling, and floor.
It is.
Yeah.
And then they're more, you know, premium bourbon, like their Booker's and Baker's and Knob Creek, is taken from that core, from the middle.
But still the same mash barrel, or mash bill?
Well, they could be different mash bills. Those could be a little different.
Oh, even
yeah,
so
yeah.
You're talking about that could be a different mash bill.
Yeah,
but it's still in the same location.
It's in the center of the warehouse. Yes, so all these Jim Beam products will be on the same mash bill on the outside of the warehouse. So this is our 80 proof. This is kind of our intro to bourbon. If you're 21, or you know, you might be probably.
And for those of you that are, you know, like, never had bourbon, I would probably say don't start on this, because the reason my thinking is that you would say, oh, it's a little harsh, it's a little rough. I would probably, if I had never had bourbon before, it would be worth your while to invest in maybe a $60 bottle of bourbon or something, just to kind of see what is, mm-hmm. what a decent bourbon tastes like. And then if you want to go back and, you know, kind of get this for a mixer, you're having a party or something, yeah, that's fine. But if you're looking at this as, I wonder if bourbon is for me, or if bourbon is something I would like, I wouldn't start that low on this end.
Yeah, or you could start out too with, what's the other big seller besides Jim Beam? When you talk about whiskey? Jack Daniels.
Yeah, okay.
You can start with the Tennessee whiskey.
First, my brain kind of messed up when you said, you didn't say bourbon.
Yeah.
Because I was thinking
whiskey.
Bourbon.
Yeah.
You're talking whiskey, yeah.
Yeah, Jack Daniels, you know, it's Tennessee whiskey, it's going to be a little sweeter. That's another good kind of starting point to get you into this.
Yep.
Get you in the bourbon.
And again, kind of like, just in my own experience, I tend to be more on the wheated end first, mm-hmm. just because it was a little easier to drink. It was a little smoother, a little sweeter.
Sweeter, yeah.
And then kind of work up a little more of the harsher, or what I thought at the time was harsher, rye-based type stuff. So.
Okay. So here's our next one, is our Jim Beam Repeal Batch. So.
And I assume repeal refers to repeal prohibition.
Prohibition.
Okay.
So we'll get a little dab of this.
When the party cranked back up.
I'll pour a little bit of that in there. So.
So now, same mash bill.
Same mash bill. So you're taking this white label right here. And you're not proofing it down as much. You're only proofing it down to 86 proof. Same years, so 4 years. 80
to 86 proof.
80 to 86 proof. And this one, because like most of the ones that were made during prohibition or, you know, repeal time prohibition, is non-chilled filtered. So if you, Mr. Scientist, can
well,
kind of tell
you what
that is.
The first time I had tried that was not too long ago, and I wasn't even aware there was a difference, and Jerry kind of started explaining it to me, and I kind of actually do a little reading on it, and it actually makes more sense that you would get more flavor, I should say a deeper and broader flavor spectrum out of non-filtered whiskey, because what happens
Non-chill filtered. Yeah.
Yeah. The way I kind of equate it in my mind is, if you're familiar with sort of like how whole milk works, basically you get milk out of a cow, you let it set, all the cream kind of comes to the top.
Mm-hmm.
When you do put new whiskey basically out of the still into the barrel, wood has a certain amount of oils and aromatic compounds in there mm-hmm. that basically get dissolved, that the alcohol acts as a solvent. And that actually kind of essentially forms a layer. You can't really see it, it's not like a grease layer, but forms a micro layer basically of oils.
Mm-hmm.
And the same way that if you chill down, for instance, butter or grease or bacon fat or something, it solidifies. That's mm-hmm. essentially the process they use to chill filters. They make it cold. It causes the oils to kind of solidify or at least coalesce and allows them to get it out of there. Some people think it makes it taste better because true, some of the oils do have a little bit of a, as you would think, an oily taste, almost like a chemical petroleum taste. But in my very limited experience, the ones you've given me, I've actually enjoyed those a little bit more because to me they have a little more flavor.
That's what people say. Yeah. I mean, really, the only reason they're doing it is because of appearance. So, especially when you're talking about lower proofs, this affects lower proofs more. Something below, 90 proof. So if you don't take those, if you don't take those out of there, those oils, esters, all that stuff, when you put a little bit of ice in here, it's going to make it cloudy.
It's cloudy. Yeah, because again, it coalesces the fatty acid chains to kind of coalesce and make it cloudy, which I kind of actually kind of like that as well. I don't know, it gives it a little character, it's a little more visual appeal. Mm-hmm. I know some people don't like that, but you don't actually see it until you do put basically the ice and maybe some cold water or something.
Yeah. If you drip something where you chill it, yes. Yep. So a little more flavor than the white label.
That's actually a pretty big, from in my taste, that's actually a pretty big jump between the two.
Yeah, this is only $20.
Yeah, of the two, if I had to choose between the two, I would definitely choose the repeal batch. That's definitely has less of a...
you can even see the legs on your glass. I mean, it's got...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So
yeah, it has definitely a deeper and wider flavor. It's more smooth, and it doesn't have that raw, kind of almost raw sawdust smell that the first one had.
All right, that's the second one. We got a few of these to go through.
Yeah, I know. So
Jim Beam makes a lot of products. So. We're
pretty small on the pours here.
So our next one is.
So in the case of this double oak, in order to keep the actual bourbon, the word bourbon, only bourbon, it has to come out of a previously brand new oak barrel, charred oak barrel, into another brand new charred oak barrel, or else it would have the word finished on there.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, this right here, it says double oak, twice barreled. So it doesn't say finished.
And we've kind of went through some of the finish,
when we talked about
the Woodford.
Yeah.
So that's a little bit of a, still in my mind, a little bit of a gray area of like, I don't know. It's a fine point, but if you still want to be called bourbon and not finished bourbon, you have to stay in new charred oak barrels. So let me give that a, is this
the double oak? Okay. Yeah. This is one of my wife's favorites. This might be the most expensive of the Jim Beam line, except for the single barrel.
You can definitely tell a difference.
About $25, yeah.
You can tell a different, picking up definitely more of the oak, but in a nice way, not in the harsh.
A lot smoother, a lot smoother. Yeah. Like I said, it's about $24-$25.
Oh yeah, that's definitely an improvement, yeah.
And you can buy this whole line of Jim Beam for less than $200.
Every bottle
on the table. Probably about more like $160, but
and it's actually pretty amazing to think that I'm getting this. That's actually a really nice flavor out of the same mash bill that basically from here.
Same mash bill, this, except it's the same proof as this one, but it is chill filter. So. Yeah. So that's
it definitely of the three that we've had so far is the smoothest.
Yes.
Yeah. It doesn't have any bite at all to it. It's just it's really smooth. Yeah, that one I would probably buy that one.
Yeah, like I said, about $25, probably the most expensive thing on the table besides the single barrel.
I would probably buy that one. Now, is this one hard to find, or is it?
No.
It's pretty
good. Any Kroger's, any place you go, will pretty much have that one every time. So, our next one is bonded. What do we mean when we say bonded?
Bib. So,
bib?
Bib.
Oh. Does that mean you're going
to bottle and bond?
I thought she was going to be slap happy with this or something.
No. So in order to be bottled in bond means it has to be at least 100 proof and at least 4 years
old. Exactly 100 proof.
Or exactly 100 proof.
Right? Yeah.
Exactly 100 proof. And a minimum of 4 years old.
Yes.
It can be older than 4 years old.
It can be, yes.
But it has to be at least 4 years old. So this kind of, the bottle and bond thing, if no one's familiar with it out there, that kind of goes all the way back to the early days of bourbon when they were really trying to fight against a lot of counterfeit bourbon, a lot of really rot gut stuff that probably, honestly, was probably poisonous for you.
Yeah.
And it was a way to kind of ensure purity, ensure quality control, and it kind of set a standard for the bourbon. It kind of gave people that were drinking the bourbon an assurance that it was good stuff, and therefore they were willing to pay more for it.
Yeah, so the Bottle and Bond Act was 1897. It stated pretty much that it had to be, this had to be stored in a federally bonded warehouse. So something under government watch.
Yeah, and they were pretty strict about that. Yes. They were not joking around about that.
And it had to be, like we said, at least 4 years old, 100 proof, and it had to be made by one distiller at one distillery
during one season.
In one, how many?
One
how many,
season, right?
Yes, how many seasons are in a year?
Well, in the bourbon year, I think there's only two, right?
There's two.
Yeah.
That's right. So it had to be made either from January to the end of June or July to the end of December. Yeah. So there's two seasons in a year.
Now, that brings up a good question. Is there any difference, or has anyone ever brought that up of like saying, this is first season bourbon or this is second season bourbon?
I've never seen that on a bottle. I've never seen it on a bottle.
Or do they ever release that? Do they ever let you know which season it was from?
Mm-mm.
Because
I don't think they have to state it.
Yeah. Yeah, just thinking about it, if you think about the ingredients, corn, it seems like that would be less mature and less flavorful from the spring if you're using stuff that's grown in the spring. Because typically all the grains are typically harvested in the fall. When they're mature and they've had time to age and fully kind of get their flavor profile. So just intuitively, I would think that a second season bourbon would be better than a first season bourbon. But perhaps they mix all the grain together. I don't know.
That's possible.
I don't know how that works.
So this is the bonded. So this is a 4 year, 100 proof. It's about $20.
I'm kind of meh on that one.
All right. It's pretty much this one.
I can tell it's a higher proof,
but it's 100 proof.
Better flavor.
Yeah. So it's the exact same thing as your white label at 100 proof.
Yeah, I'm definitely more of still a fan of either the double peel or the double oak.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this tastes exactly what you just described. It just tastes like a hotter version of the white label. That's exactly what it tastes like. I'm back to that harsh, harsher on the, it's not bad, it's not like it's awful, but it's harsher on the nose and definitely harsher on my tongue and lips.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for me, that wouldn't, having the fact that it's bottle and bond wouldn't be a plus for me on that.
Just and because that is for a lot of people. Yeah. I mean, bottle and bond's a big thing for people.
Mm-mm.
Halfway through.
For me, that wouldn't be a calling card or a calling point on this to pay. Mm-hmm. So this is, what did you say, this is 25?
20.
20, okay.
Yeah, the most expensive one besides the single barrel.
Oh, this one was the 25.
Is the double oak, yes.
All right. Okay. I was going to say, if that's the same price, I would definitely go with the double oak. But I would still pay the $5 extra for that.
I would too. So now we're up to the fifth one. Oh. We got the Jim Beam Distiller's Cut. I'm gonna let you try this one.
Now, is this a Distiller's Cut as in Freddie Beam?
Well,
is that who's choosing this, or?
This is, you're getting your non-chill filter again, so you're getting this.
I like the
so you're getting this. You're actually getting 100 proof, like the bonded, but you're also adding an extra year to it. So you're getting a 5 year.
So it should be a little more, proof, little more smooth, a little more mellow.
Non-chill filter.
Oh, okay, this one sounds like it may have prospects.
So a little bit extra in age. You've got the 100 proof, and you've got the non-chill filter. So you got that.
It definitely smells smoother. It doesn't have quite the bite that this last one. I'm not a big fan of the 100 proof bond.
So this is $25, so it's about the same price as the Bottle and Bond.
Alright. That's actually pretty good. Yeah. Yeah, that one's actually pretty good.
So you should draw, flavors out of it like you do the repeal batch.
I was gonna say
it's gonna be a higher proof and a year older.
That this one is you can definitely or I can pick up the extra flavor of the non-chill filter.
Mm-hmm.
I like that. That may be my way to go.
I know I always do these blind tastings on my wife. She went through this whole thing.
Oh, and she picked the double oak though, right?
No, she actually picked The Distiller's Cut is our favorite.
Oh, really? No, yeah. Like I said, this one's actually pretty good. This one's, yeah, it's got the smoothness, while at the same time got just enough higher proof bite to it to give you that little bit of a warm Kentucky hug. But still, the flavor profile of the until I'm liking that. It's actually pretty good. So this is $20. So this same price on these two.
Yes. Yes. All right. So sure is on the
of the two.
Double
it would be
one.
Basically a toss up, but I would probably go with the Distiller's Cut.
Yeah.
I agree.
Higher proof. Yeah. Look, year older.
Yeah, that's actually.
This one's probably a little smoother. I think this one has a little more flavor.
I agree. I agree with you 100%. This one is smoother on the tongue. It's got a little more almost of a silkiness. It's not quite as that rough sensation, but this one definitely has a little deeper flavor. So I think I'd go with the flavor. I like that one.
All right, we're up to number six.
We're at number six.
There's a lot to go through here.
That's a lot of Bean makes a wide.
They do. Thing. From this.
From one from mash.
One thing. So we got the Jim Beam Black. So this is supposed to be extra age. It used to be listed at like at least 8 years. Now they say it's about 6 years.
Oh, it doesn't have an age. I don't see any age.
No, you don't have to. Age statements, they only have to be on there if it's less than 4 years. Once you get above 4 years, you don't have to put an age on there unless you want to.
Although James B. Beam says that none is genuine without his signature.
Oh, okay. His signature's on it. But his age statement's
on it. That's his actual signature as opposed to just the label. But
yeah. So the Jim Beam Black Extra Aged is at least 6 years old. And it goes back down to 86 proof. So it goes
back down to
the repeal batch, proof.
So it's basically the repeal batch older. But is this non-chill filter?
It's not a non-chill filter. So it's the Jim Beam White.
So they have about four or five parameters here that they're kind of mixing and matching with. Okay.
Jim Beam White. It's at age at least 2 years longer. And it's 86 proof and still 80.
Okay.
So if you want to pour that out.
Yeah, so let's give us a little
bit of that.
A little taste of this.
Use it all. You have to watch him. He pours like.
Yeah, the
huge
last couple times I poured a little deep. All right, so let's give that a whirl.
So when they talk about white and black, that's what they're talking about. They're two most popular bourbons.
I'm still a fan, even in the look in the glass of the non-chill filter. I like the way that it gives you a little extra legs for the oil.
It does, it does. If you notice that, if you're talking about legs coming down the sides of the glass, yes.
Yeah, you can definitely tell.
If you do the swirl,
on the non-chill filter, you can definitely see the alcohol separates from the oil a lot more than the others. I like, I kind of like that. It's definitely sweeter for some reason.
It is sweeter, yes.
It's quite a bit sweeter, almost a wheat. Really sweet actually. After a long aftertaste, I'm getting a lot of sweet corn, almost like if your mama cut the corn off the cob. You had some good corn.
So it's 2 years older than the
salmon
label.
Salmon patties, corn, oh yeah.
Yeah, 2 years older with, 86 proof compared to 80 proof.
Well, it's definitely smoother and sweeter. It doesn't have as deep a flavor for me.
It doesn't as the non-chill filter.
I agree. It's almost to me, it's almost too sweet, too light. Yeah, it doesn't have that character. It just probably wouldn't. That one might not be my favorite choice.
Well, if you look at the Hope rankings, actually, this one was last, of course. The white label.
And all these are
blind. Next to last.
And all these are blind.
Yes. Okay. Next to last was the extra age.
All right, I'm with Hope. I'm going to coattail on Hope. So that, I can see why the white label is definitely the cheapest end of the thing. That's probably not, like I said, if I was brand new to bourbon, I wouldn't recommend people to drink that. It's not bad. It's just not very flavorful.
Yeah. $25.
Yeah.
So it's the same price
for the $25. I would either go with Distillers or the
Double
Oak.
Yeah.
And probably the Distillers.
Yep. All right. We're getting close. Almost to the end. Yeah.
I don't know. That one's kind of like if someone said, "Hey, here's a free bourbon," I'd drink it. But I don't think I would pay for it.
Next one is our Devil's Cut. This is different.
That sounds bad. I've never had
this. One's different.
I've never had this.
A little bit different than the rest of them.
Extra aged in the heart of Kentucky Jim Beam's Devil's Cut Kentucky Straight Bourbon is for those who take the whiskey seriously.
That's right, serious.
I'm not sure if that's me.
So this one is like the extra age, so it's about 6 years. It's a little bit higher proof at 9.
Now when you say about 6 years, is it guaranteed at least 6 years?
It's about 6 years plus. That, you know. All right. So it's about 6 years plus. And it's 90 proof, so it's a little bit higher proof than the extra age. But what they do on this one is kind of like we talked about what Glen's Creek does with their premium OCD 5.
Well,
they're getting this.
I'm a big fan of the OCD 5s.
Yeah. Yes, they're getting this from the char.
Ooh.
So they're pulling this from the wood.
Maybe good stuff. Though.
Yeah, they're pulling this from the wood. So they're actually, you know, what's left in the barrel after they dump it.
So this is.
They're pressurizing that.
Oh, they're pressurizing the barrel?
Yes, and pulling that out and putting all that together. Kind of like OCD number 5.
I may like this then.
Yeah, so this is what they call the Devil's Cut. So this is not the Angel Share, which evaporates
that
up to the warehouse. Yes.
That makes sense. Okay, I get
this.
This
is what stays in the barrel.
I get why they call it that. Yeah. And you know, that's one thing I've always wondered about, and the reason I say that is with the photography, I actually got rid of my barrel prop. But I bought a used bourbon barrel in Bardstown, actually, and at the time I bought it, it was still wet. So it had, I guess, a lot of still whiskey left in it. And you could actually smell that thing for months at a time, and you could still smell it coming out. Like, man, that really smells good.
Good, yes.
Yeah, and then after a while, I started noticing that the rings around the barrel were starting to, like, you know, fall. And because when whiskey barrels dry out, they shrink.
Mm-hmm.
And the rings that keep them tight will actually fall off.
Mm-hmm.
So in my mind, I'm like, wow, that has got to be a decent amount of volume in order to shrink that much to have, because clearly the still rings don't change size.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to think of how much bourbon is still left inside the wood that's still evaporating all the time. So that's actually a good idea.
So they're pressurizing this and putting it all together.
Yeah.
So this is what they call the
Devil's Cut. Now, do they do kind of the Glen's Creek thing where they use the sludge part as well?
Well, they're pressurizing, pulling that you know, wood from the char, and they're putting it all together into one barrel.
Ooh, I'm liking that. Mm-hmm. Now, this is chill filtered too, though.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Not a non-chill filter.
I can tell it doesn't have quite the depth of taste, and it doesn't have the legs.
Mm-hmm.
But it definitely has a richer flavor, just because it has been pulled out of the wood. I'm actually like this beer. Do they make this in a non-chilled version?
Not that. No. No. Be nice. You might want to suggest that to
them. I will. Jim Beam, if you're watching this, please make this a non-chilled version, and you got a winner. I'm telling you. But yeah, call it maybe, I don't know, up. You can probably still go with the Devil's Cut name, but maybe make it, I don't know. I would also change the bottle label. I don't think the label is quite as nice as.
Oh, you don't?
I don't think so. I think it looks a little too, I don't want to say rednecky, but yeah, kind of like that. I don't know.
Okay.
I like more vintage looking labels.
Mm-hmm.
On the bottles, I just feel like it kind of gives it a little more nostalgia, a little more character.
The Minor Case.
Oh, Minor Case.
And Limestone Ranch has that. Yeah,
favorite,
with the raised letters.
Yeah, one of my favorite bottles.
Yeah.
The old Rippy bottle looks really nice. The
it
label.
Does. Which
the
is actually case. Way up here behind us. I don't know if you can see it or not.
I don't know if you can see that, but it's one of my favorite bottles. Yeah. But, and for me, that's actually part of the experience because to me, drinking mostly bourbon is kind of what we focus on, but should be more about than just doing like tequila shots.
Mm-hmm.
That's the kind of reason I'm like, that's not for me.
Sip it.
Right, exactly. It's more of a sipping thing, and it's more of a, I get to enjoy the beautiful color. I see the light coming through.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the bottle's pretty, the label's pretty. I like the smell, I like the legs.
The color come from the barrel. It's not artificial.
So for me, the enjoyment of bourbon is more about the whole experience as opposed to just like, give me a shot of that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So, In that vein, I would recommend Jim Beam. You do a bottle change, label change, and you got a winner. It's still pretty good.
It's not bad though.
Yeah, that's still
it's
pretty not good. Bad. I agree. That's actually pretty good. Of the ones, it would be definitely a toss up on that one. That's actually
that was about $20.
Yeah, that's actually
so you can get there for like $20. Like so our last one.
Our last one. This may be the best of all.
It's single barrel. Now I won't say where Hope put this one. So I'll let you all decide.
Right, so this is on this one at least is 108 proof.
108 proof.
Now that will change.
Depending on the barrel.
Depending on the barrel.
Yes. There's no age statement on it, so we don't know exactly how old it is. I'm thinking hopefully it's at least like 6 years old.
At least
6 years old. But it's 108 proof. So this one is a little more expensive. This was in the $30 range, so being a single barrel.
So this is barrel number JB00327138, which gives you an idea how many barrels they actually have.
Just a few.
they have a few barrels.
Yeah.
So now this is selected batch, but then it says single barrel.
Mm-hmm.
So does that mean this came out of literally one barrel?
As long as it's got the barrel listed on there. If it's got the actual barrel listed on there.
It has to come out of one single barrel.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right. Yeah, if you're going to pour a little bit of that.
Yep.
So this is our last one. So we're talking about going from
hoping this is
no more than 90 proof on any of these up to 108. So we're increasing the proof. So we're hoping that it's like a extra age, so at least about
now,
6 years old
when
or so.
When you buy this off the shelf, it could range from what?
All the proofs could range from anything. I mean, they're going to be 100 plus, but
so
when you're talking about barrel
proof. You could potentially pick this up and it would say 116 proof.
Depending
something.
On what they have right. that year, yes. Right. Yeah. Like we said, you know, the proof of bourbon age, you know, it increases as the age goes up. So
yeah, which is
water evaporates.
Yep.
Yeah. Alcohol stays in, so.
Yeah, and that's, water is a very small molecule, alcohol, and it's not only that, it's the large esters that come out of the wood that are the huge molecules that can't pass through the wood.
So this one's about 30-some bucks.
This is filtered though, right?
Yes. Yeah.
That's actually pretty good. It's a little rougher, not as smooth as I was expecting, but it is out of a single barrel, so.
Mm-hmm. So out of the eight, Hope had this ranked number six.
I can see that. Like I said, it's not quite as smooth as I was expecting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So
I would probably put that below distiller's cut. It would be hard for me to pick between the distiller's cut and double oak.
Mm-hmm.
So these would tie for first.
Mm-hmm.
For me, this would be definitely a clear second, probably a third, and a fourth.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you like that non-chill filter.
Mm-hmm.
So it'd be your pretty much your third and fourth.
And also the non-chill filter for me has a better mouth feel. Mm-hmm. You can almost feel the oils in it. It almost has a smoother silky kind of feel on your tongue. It may just be my imagination knowing that it's not filtered, but.
So you see where we're talking about how we combined all the bourbon 101s we talked about so far. So we know how the Jim Beam products are placed in the warehouse.
Yeah, so you've got warehouse placement, you've got proof involved.
You got proof.
You've got essentially finishing, but not, they don't call it finishing, but they're putting
the
in double oak.
Yes.
What else we got? We've got chip filtered or versus non-filtered.
Non-filter, yes.
What else do we have?
We got proof.
Yeah.
How proof makes a difference.
Yeah.
You know, going from 80 to 86 or up to 108.
Yeah. And so the only constant variable through all this is mash bill.
Mash bill.
So mash bill, same.
All the same.
Can be different in proof, can be different where it's in the warehouse, can be different as far as finishing or whatever happens to it after it comes in the first barrel.
Mm-hmm.
Aging is different and filtering different. So you have five variables, one constant.
One constant.
Okay.
This.
There you go, that. Which probably is better left for college parties and hooch development.
I mean, you pick what you like here. Like I said, you can buy all of these for maybe $160 or $170, the whole shebang on here. There's a couple.
Yeah, it's actually pretty amazing to think you can get literally this entire thing for what you can buy one bottle of considerably what is now actually mid-range. You know, it used to be like, oh gosh, if I pay $200 for a bottle of bourbon, it was outrageous.
Mm-hmm.
Now bourbon
that's
is
a mid-range. Yes,
bourbon is like $2,000, $3,000 for some of the higher end
stuff.
And some of the really rare stuff is just basically whatever they can get for it. So you can get all of this, which is all very, very drinkable, very enjoyable. For me, honestly, I probably wouldn't, unless someone made me.
30 years ago, maybe.
So unless someone made me, I probably wouldn't tackle that one. But I would most certainly, if you want to stock something in your cabinet that's just nice to go to, that you have friends over, here, definitely the Repeal. I like that one because of the non-chill filter. Distiller's Cut is good, and Devil's Cut.
Yeah.
All of those are going to be good drinkable bourbons. And of course, if you've noticed, we're drinking all this kind of straight. I'm not sure how neat, I should say. It would be interesting to know how things like, how does water change it? How does an ice cube change it? How does a little bit of Coke or ginger ale change it? That's a little bit sacrilege for actual.
You've got all that stuff. And plus food. Whatever food you have.
And food, yes.
Yeah, I mean, if you want, if this is not enough proof for you, Lowell, you can actually take peanuts or a salt of meat, so like a country ham. And this will increase that for you. Make it a little bit more potent, you know, a little bit stronger.
Yeah, and that's an interesting thing because I know I've, actually I remember watching a couple of videos when you and I did the homebrew kind of thing. I was watching some videos on how to pair different types of beer with different types of food, which is, there's a whole, that's a whole other world of, you know, of alcohol science and etiquette. But there is also sort of that whole world of which spirits, to, and even more specifically, which bourbon to pair with, you know, whether it's chicken or lamb or beef or whatever it is.
So if this one is too strong for you, 108 proof, you could take some aged Gouda or some dark chocolate.
I was going to say chocolate actually.
Dark chocolate.
Surprisingly good with bourbon.
It is dark chocolate. Dried cranberries.
I can see that.
Dried fruit.
I can see dried fruit.
You can pair that
like
with something that maybe is something
like
a little
that.
Strong for you.
Yeah.
And actually, especially aged Gouda, it like coats your tongue.
Yep.
And it makes it a little more palatable.
I could definitely see some cheeses with some of this, some dried fruits with some of this, even like a fruit with a cracker kind of a thing. I can definitely see where it would be a good compliment on all that.
So this is Jim Beam. I mean, this is taking all we've done so far in the first three and kind of talking about it all here. They do a little bit of everything to get these products from
Just to be clear, this isn't everything that Jim Beam offers.
No, they have Booker's, which we tasted in our Jim Beam, you know, our Beam episodes, which was pretty awesome. It's like 126 proof.
Yeah.
They have like Baker's. They have Basil's. They have Basil Hayden.
Yep.
Old Granddad.
Old Granddad.
Knob Creek.
Yeah. Which Basil's and Old Granddad are all
same person. Yep. So this is mostly their economical line, as you were saying.
Yeah, so this is actually, as many as this is still sort of their, what they would consider more the economical.
This is their cowhide of a baseball.
This is the cowhide.
Yes, it's not the core. So I mean, just, you know, it's just enjoy it. I mean, you can find something that's $25-$30 and actually enjoy it a little bit.
Yes, without question, I could sit down with any of these three choices, this one, and enjoy it as much as probably Booker's or anything, you know, any of the other high-end things. You know, it's just, some of it is, it gets down to such fine subtlety. Some of it is honestly in your mind of like, oh, this is a nice bourbon, so it should taste better. So the expectation causes it to taste better. Yep. But on a blind taste test, I doubt I would be able to pick out, you know, if someone gave me a glass of Pappy Van Winkle and, you know, like we talked about, like Weller's, I doubt that I would have the ability to change that out. But some of it is just knowing that you paid that much more for it. And some of it is, you know, it's a social convention. It's like,
hey,
you know, enjoy some of this nice whiskey that I paid for. So.
But you don't have to pay, you know, you can pay $25 to actually enjoy something.
You can still get something really nice.
Yes. So that's what
we're going to have one more before we finish out. Which one you're going to pick your favorite, and we're going to have one more.
What is your favorite? My favorite is Distiller's Cut. I like that non-chill feel.
I was going to say, I'm probably going to go with either that or the Repeal, but since you're... have that one open, I think that will be my choice.
Yes. So cheers to everybody.
So, and I think if I ever make a batch of bourbon, That's illegal, by the way, so I'm not going to do it. But if I ever were, just saying, if I ever were, I would probably go with a non-chill filter type setup. Because I think the oils actually add something to it. I think it adds visual appeal in the legs. I think it adds a little something on the nose. And it definitely adds a silkiness in my mouth and a depth of flavor. So.
And if you do it, don't do all eight at once.
Yeah, don't do all eight at once. So.
Cheers.
Cilantro.
Drinking dark whiskey, telling white lies. One leads to another.